Certainly good to be back tonight, and we welcome everybody to the service this evening. Thank you in advance for your presence, especially if you've driven a ways to be here. We are not unaware of that fact, and we thank you for putting this meeting in your schedule. Tonight, I'd like to read a very familiar passage recorded in the fourth chapter of the book of Genesis, beginning with verse 3 and reading down through verse 10. Genesis chapter 4, beginning with verse 3. And in the process of time, the Bible says that it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of fruit of the ground to the Lord. And Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. So the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you, but you should rule over it." Now Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass that they were in the field. Cain rose up against Abel his brother and killed him. And the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And he said, "What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground." If correctly read, that reads these verses, verses 3 through 10 of Genesis chapter 4. Tonight we entitle our lesson, "A Good Question with a Bad Answer." And we want to talk about that, but before we do, we have a wonderful opportunity to pray, and we ask you to humble yourself in some way while we do.
206.
There are many men and women in this world who perform very proficiently in the particular job or vocation that they follow in life. Some of these jobs require a great deal of skill and learning, education. And yet these men are able to tackle the problems that they're confronted with and come out with great results. There are some women who carry heavy burdens in life, and they are proficient at what they do, being a good wife, a good mother. Sometimes they have a vocation that they follow, and they're very successful in what they have chosen to do. But these same people who are so outstanding and proficient in what they do have great difficulty with interpersonal relationships. They have a hard time communicating with other people. They have a hard time expressing their feelings. They have a hard time discussing differences and issues. The Bible, I believe, plainly teaches that responsibility is a cardinal principle of Bible teaching, and yet social irresponsibility is prevalent both in the world and in the church. There are people out in the world who just seemingly can't get along with each other. That's why we have wars. We have people in the world who disagree with one another to the point that they fight and sometimes spend billions of dollars getting even with one another. And unfortunately, sometimes we have people in the church who just can't get along. Sometimes we have families that can't get along. Husbands can't get along with their wives. Parents can't get along with their children, and vice versa. Men and women on every hand, even the most religious, are seemingly indifferent to the responsibility that we sustain to our fellow man. As Christians, the Bible, I believe, teaches very plainly that we are our brother's keeper. We have obligations and duties to one another that cannot be overlooked without disregard for plain Bible teaching. When asked about Abel as to where he was, Cain said, "I don't know." He did. He lied about that, but he said, "I don't know." And then came the insult, "Am I my brother's keeper? Why do I need to know? Why do I need to be concerned about where my brother is? That's not my job. That's not my responsibility." And it was, of course, his cool insolence that might have been an indication of the state of his heart that actually led him to murder his brother in the first place. Strained relationships often lead to trouble, which is why we need to care enough about one another to discharge our duties to each other as the Bible directs us to do. What about our brothers who no longer come to church? Does anybody care enough to go and find out why? What about the people who at one time were faithful in their service but no longer are? What about our brothers and sisters in the church that battle domestic problems and live very difficult lives, sometimes even ending in the dissolution of the family? What about our brothers who go astray after false teachers and false teaching? Or those who are caught hopelessly in the snares of the evil one? How do we deal with all that? How does it affect us? Do we go out and do our very best to regain them? Do we talk with them about their problems? Do we try to help them solve their problems? Or do we just turn a deaf ear to what they say and forget that they're our brothers in the first place? We don't choose our spiritual family just as we did not choose our physical family. I didn't choose my parents. I was born into that family. I didn't choose my sister. She didn't choose me. We were born into the same family. We didn't choose each other as members of the church. I didn't choose you. You didn't choose me. We're brothers and sisters in Christ because we have the same Father. And we were born into the family of God. And we, as members of the church, are part of God's family. And the Bible describes us as a brotherhood. And the Bible speaks very plainly about our relationship to each other. It speaks very plainly about how we should treat each other and how we should deal with each other in good times and in bad times as well. And I want to talk to you today about that. And I want to begin by pointing out that Solomon said in Proverbs 18 and verse 19, a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. Now we know that it's very difficult to win a strong city. We know that any army going against another city has to be very careful about how they approach that city, about how they deal with the problem of overtaking and overcoming it and capturing it. And by the same token, the Bible says if you offend your brother, it's going to be very difficult to win him back. In Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17, Jesus addressed that very topic when he said, "Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you've gained your brother. But if he will not hear you, then take with you one or two more, and by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector." Jesus laid down, I believe, what all might consider a very simple procedure here. And I believe when that simple procedure is followed, it generally works. However, if we ignore that procedure and do the very opposite, then obviously we only compound the problem. Notice, first of all, Jesus said, if your brother sins against you, go to him and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. He didn't say, now, tell everybody else what he's done to you. He didn't say, when it happens, you turn around and say, did you hear what he said to me? No, he didn't say that. He didn't say, when you're offended by someone, go and tell the brethren in the church how you've been mistreated. He said, go to him. Go to your brother. When your brother does something against you that is wrong, go to your brother and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. Think about that, alone. You know, there's reason to encapsulate that thing so that it doesn't get out. There's reason to try and resolve it before it spreads. There's reason to try and solve it before it grows. And so Jesus said, go to him and talk to him. I believe the Lord indicated here that that probably was the beginning of the resolution. Just by the two of you talking in private, you might be able to work it out. You should be able to work it out. But if he won't hear you, then you go and you get two or three other brethren and you take them with you and you talk to him again. And if he won't hear them, then it's time to bring it before the church. And if he won't hear the church, then it's time to take disciplinary action against him. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 23, he said, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother hath aught against thee, go and first be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. Now, I believe the Lord teaches that this personal problem right here is so great that you really need to go straighten that out before you come and worship. If you bring your gift to the altar and you know that you've harmed someone, you've hurt someone, you've sinned against someone, you need to go and be reconciled to your brother. You know that your brother's aware of all that, and you go and try to be reconciled to him. Then you come and offer your gift. You know, if in both of these situations the people involved had a spirit of forgiveness, the difficulty would vanish. Paul declared in Colossians 3 and verse 13, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. Now, many times where we fail in our interpersonal relationship with each other, we tell somebody else, and it soon spreads and everybody knows about it, sometimes even before this brother knows about it. Sometimes even before he becomes aware of it, and the farther it travels, then the more difficult it is to resolve the situation, because far too many people have heard about it, and many of them have heard the wrong thing when they heard about it, because it was second or third information or knowledge that came to them. The Lord had a reason for saying, Solomon had a reason for saying, it's hard to gain an offended brother. It's hard to deal with an offended brother, and in order to prevent that, these are the steps Jesus said that you need to follow. But you know, the Bible also points out, I believe, that we should never imagine evil against our brother. Actually, in Zechariah 7, verse 10, and let none of you, the King James Version says, imagine evil against his brother in your heart. Many of the revisions say, and let none of you plan evil against your brother in your heart. And that probably is the better idea. It's an idea that essentially says we need to be careful about the attitude we have toward our brother and what we say about him. Often, for various reasons, we think the very worst of people rather than the very best. And if we are not careful, we pass judgment without justification. We assume that's what he meant. We assume that's what he or she was trying to do. We think that perhaps they had that in mind. And so our conclusion is that's the way that it actually was. Now, over in Matthew 7, Jesus said, beginning in verse 1, judge not that ye be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you. And that raises the question, what judgment is the Lord talking about? What judgment of our fellow man is prohibited, and what judgment of our fellow man is permitted? Sometimes I hear brethren say, well, you know, the Bible teaches that it's wrong to judge one another. No, the Bible doesn't teach that. The Bible doesn't teach that it's wrong to judge one another. The Bible does teach that there's a certain kind of judgment that's wrong, and the Bible teaches that we should not participate or be a party to that kind of judgment. And when Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged, what was he talking about? Well, before we answer that, I want to offer a few points for consideration. Number one, the judgment condemned by Jesus in Matthew 7 does not prohibit the church from exercising discipline, because the church is commanded to discipline a brother. In fact, in Matthew chapter 18, you remember, if this man refused to hear you, and you take two or three with you, and he refuses to hear them, and then he refuses to hear the church, Jesus said, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a publican. That's discipline. Now, there had to be some judgment involved in this. There had to be something for which the brother was guilty. He had to be confronted with that guilt, whatever it may have been. He refused to repent of that act, whatever it was. And the Bible says, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a publican. Over in Titus 3:10, Paul said, reject a divisive man after the first and second admonition, knowing that such a person is warped and sinning, being self-condemned. There had to be judgment involved in that. You can't just go out here and reject any man. That man has to be guilty of factions. He has to be guilty of being a divisive man. There has to be a judgment involved in that matter. Look at 2 John chapter 10. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, receive him not into your house, nor greet him, for he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. That is, we cannot in any way encourage the person in what he is doing or aid him in any way that would further the destructive course of his action. There has to be judgment involved here. If anyone comes to you and doesn't bring this doctrine, you've got to make a determination what he did bring. You've got to decide whether or not what he brought was right or what he brought was wrong. And for someone to stand back and say, well, you know, the Bible says we shouldn't judge each other, therefore we're just not going to exercise any discipline on this man because we don't want to be the judge. We'll let God do that. God said, I want you to do that. God said, that's the responsibility of the church to do that. Look again at 2 Thessalonians 3 and 6. But we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw from every brother that walks disorderly and not according to the tradition which he received from us. Now, the people that were walking disorderly here were people that wouldn't work and provide for their family. If you read the context of 2 Thessalonians 3, he's talking about men who won't work, and Paul said if you don't work, you shouldn't eat. And these men who wouldn't go out and get a job and provide for their family, if they persisted in that, Paul said, you need to withdraw yourselves from them. Had to be some judgment involved in that. Some way you have to judge and determine whether or not a man is fulfilling his duty in that respect. And they were to keep away from those who were idle and not working and supporting their family. Now, keeping away did not mean that they couldn't speak to them, because the Bible says they were to admonish them as a brother. They were to actually talk to them about their sin and try to get them to repent. Now take the case of the immoral man in 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul commanded, you are to deliver such an one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, which I believe meant they were to withdraw fellowship from him and have absolutely nothing to do with him. Had to be judgment involved. You know, here's a man who's living with his stepmother. And as a result of that, some of the church was glorying about it, and Paul said, that's not good. Now, somebody in that congregation had to make a determination about the man's sin, about the life he was living, what needed to be done in order to correct that, what needed to be done to save the man or save the church. You have judgment throughout. And so when Jesus said, judge not that ye be not judged, he's not talking about matters like these. He's not saying you can never make a determination about whether a man is doing wrong or teaching wrong. Sometimes people say, well, you know, I know what he says, but I just don't want to judge him. I got news for you. You have to judge him. You really do. You have to determine whether or not he's preaching the truth or not. And you have to determine whether he's living right or whether he's not living right. Well, if it doesn't prohibit that, what does it prohibit? Well, let me go one step farther. It does not prohibit private judgment as to wrongdoers. In other words, there has to be some judgment made with reference to people that are doing wrong. Look at Romans 6 and verse 17. Mark them which cause division and offenses. Somebody's got to decide whether a man's causing division or not. Somebody has to make a decision whether or not this man is causing offenses. Look at 1 John 4:1. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits. Try the spirits, whether they are of God, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. How do you determine whether a man is a false prophet or not if you don't pass judgment on what he teaches? You had to. These people had to. 1 Corinthians 5:11. Paul said, but now I have written to you to not keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral. Who determines whether a person's sexually immoral or not? Somebody has to make a determination about that. Or covetous, or an idolater, or a reviler, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. How do you determine whether a man's a drunkard or not unless you see him drinking and stone drunk? If you see a man out here who gets drunk all the time and you say there's a drunkard, you haven't judged the man in the sense that Jesus condemns judgment. You merely are recognizing the facts that can't be denied. So what does it prohibit? Well, it prohibits rash, censorious, and uncharitable judgments. It, of course, prohibits a fault-finding spirit that condemns upon surmise without examination of the charges. In other words, if you come to me and say, I think Jim is drinking, I can't get up and say, brethren, we need to withdraw from Jim because Jim's drinking. I've got to find out whether Jim's drinking or not. I've got to find out whether that charge is correct or not. I've got to determine whether or not there's guilt here or not. I cannot just say the man is guilty and everybody believe it and the church exercise discipline with reference to that person. Our judgment of other Christians must be charitable in view of the fact that God will be the judge of all. In John 7:24, do not judge, and this is a key passage now, Jesus said, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Now, before we determine what that means, let me point out to you that we all know that a tree is known by its fruit. When I look at an apple tree laden with apples and I say, look at that apple tree, there's no judgment involved there. I mean, the apples are there. It's evident that that's an apple tree. I judge by the fruit on that tree. If I see a man with a gun in his hand about to shoot another man, and I stand there and watch him pull the trigger, and the other man drops dead, and I tell someone, he shot that man. I'm not judging that man. I saw it. The evidence is there. Now, a lot of times people say, you know, well, you shouldn't judge a person. Well, when you merely point out what a person does, you're not judging them because it's evident what they've done. I don't know why he did it, and here's what's wrong. Here's the difference between judgment that's condemned and righteous judgment. If I see this same man pull out his gun, shoot this man, I don't know, I just see him do that. And I say, hey, did you see that guy shoot that man? That man was running around with his wife. Well, I don't know that. I don't even know who the man is. I don't have a right to attribute the cause of why he shot him. I recognize the fact that he shot him, but I don't have a right to say why he did it because I don't know. And by the same token, I have to be careful that I don't attribute to people motives that are not theirs. I don't have that right. I can't say a certain man is preaching for money. That's wrong. I can't say that. I don't know what's in that man's heart. I can't say or tell you why certain people do what they do. That's not righteous judgment. And righteous judgment is not wrong. The Bible plainly teaches that. Now, let me take this just a little bit further. When I say to an unbeliever, I hear people say all the time that preachers ought to be careful and they shouldn't say that certain people are going to hell. Well, if I say to an unbeliever, that man is lost, I'm not judging that man because Jesus said, unless you believe that I am he, ye shall die in your sins, and where I go, ye cannot come. When I state that an unbeliever can't go to heaven, I'm merely saying what Jesus said. That's all I'm doing. I'm recognizing the truth of what Jesus said. I'm applying the law of Christ. I do no wrong when I apply the law of Christ. We have the right to judge in matters where the law of the Scripture is broken or disregarded. And when people break the law of God and disregard the law of God, and I point out what they have done, I have that right. But now let's go back to John 7. That's where this passage says to judge righteous judgment. Do not judge according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. Here was the context. The Jews accused Christ of violating the law of the Sabbath because he healed a man on the Sabbath. There was a man who was sick. Jesus healed that man. It was on the Sabbath day. The Jews said, the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. You violated the law of the Sabbath by healing this man on the Sabbath day. Now, Jesus brought up a counter argument. And he said, you know, the law also declares that little boy children need to be circumcised on the eighth day. And even if the eighth day falls on the Sabbath day, they still have to be circumcised on that day. Because that's what the law said. And in that particular connection, Jesus says the law of circumcision superseded the law of the Sabbath. Even though they were to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, because they were to circumcise their little boys on the eighth day, if the eighth day happened to fall on the Sabbath day, they still had to circumcise their little boys. That's why he said, you judge righteous judgment. You take into account what's being done, and you take into account why it's being done. If I don't take into account what's being done, if I don't take into account why it's done, if I don't know, I don't have the right to judge. That's not righteous judgment when I attribute to people motives they don't have. It's not righteous judgment when I say people do things when they may not be doing it for that purpose at all. And Jesus said, that's true with me healing this man on the Sabbath. Just as you will circumcise your little children on the Sabbath, I heal this man on the Sabbath, and I don't break the law of the Sabbath when I do that. Had they judged with righteous judgment, they would have taken into account the deed of Christ and the circumstances that surround it. And by the same token, we ought to do the same thing today. We should be very careful that we don't attribute to people motives they don't have. I don't have that right. We should be very careful not to say this man did that because of this when I don't know that's why he did it. Perfectly fine if I point out what he did. Perfectly fine if I say he violated the law of God. But I have to be careful that I do not attribute a motive to that action which did not exist. But I need to hurry. Number three, the Bible teaches that we should not put a stumbling block in the way of our brother. Here's a problem that many people I don't believe understand. In Romans 14 and verse 4, Paul said that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. Again, in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 12, but when you thus sin against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother to stumble, I will never again eat meat, lest I make my brother to stumble. Now, what is Paul saying here? And how does that relate to us today? Well, if you study the context of 1 Corinthians chapter 8, it involves the eating of meat that had been offered to idols. Now, in these idols' temple, they would take this meat and they would offer it to idols. It was perfectly good meat. And after, of course, they got through with that, some of that meat was sold in the marketplace and people would buy it and they would eat it. Now, a weak brother, when he would eat that meat offered to idols, would wound his conscience since he really believes to do so is wrong. He didn't understand that there was really nothing right or wrong in and of itself with the eating of meat. But he wounded his own conscience, he violated his own conscience when he ate that meat that had been offered to idols or that had been used in an idol's temple. And by doing so, he defiled his conscience. Now, the eating of meats itself was a liberty in some cases, but not in cases of false worship or eating them in the idol's temple. You couldn't go there in that idol's temple and participate in that service where they were offering this meat. But once it was all done with and the meat was taken out and sold in the marketplace, there wasn't anything wrong with buying that meat and eating that meat. That idol worship was all over with now, and you weren't a part of that at all. However, Paul teaches here now that the strong man should not use the liberty he has in buying that meat later and eating it if it caused a weak brother to offend, if it actually caused a weak brother to eat it, believing that in the process of doing it, he was sinning. And he said, you know, to sin against a brother is to sin against Christ. And here's the lesson. Here's the lesson for all of us. We should never do anything that will cause a weak brother or sister to do something he believes to be wrong. He sincerely believes it's wrong, and we should never do anything that will cause him to do that. We should be aware of his weakness. We should be aware of his feelings, his conscience in such matters, and we are to work for his salvation rather than his destruction. Now, this verse is misused by a lot of people in the church today because they will say, you shouldn't do that because that offends me. Now, you know what they mean by that? I don't like for you to do it. When they say that offends me, I don't want you to do that. I'd just rather you didn't do that. That's not what Paul had in mind when he said what he said and taught what he taught. And that's not the way Paul used this word, if I make my brother to offend. He wasn't talking about somebody just got their feelings hurt. He wasn't talking about somebody that just didn't want you to do something or didn't approve of what you were doing. He was talking about a man who was encouraged or inclined to do something because of your actions that this man really believed was wrong. And that's how we make our brothers to offend. We make them to offend when by our actions we encourage them in doing something that they themselves are convinced is a sin. Number four, we should restore our fallen brother. Paul said if a man is overtaken in a fault, in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Most of the revisions correctly translate that. Brethren, if a man is surprised in a fault. The point here is a person who did not intentionally enter sin. It's a person who was surprised, a person who was deceived, a person who was overtaken in a trespass. We all, of course, have a duty to those who fall by the wayside, and so many, many have. Almost anywhere I go, there are almost as many people out of the church as there are in the church who at one time were in the church because they've fallen away. Where I live right now, if we had everybody in the church in LaGrange, Georgia, that had been in the church in LaGrange and still live in LaGrange, the building wouldn't hold them. That's the honest truth. They've fallen away. And the Bible says that we have a duty to those who fall away. And this verse addresses these people who were surprised by an unintentional fault. And we're to go after them in bringing them back. But notice carefully that Paul said you need to consider yourself. Consider yourself. In other words, consider that it could happen to you. Most of us don't like to think about that. Most of us like to believe that we would never, in a moment of temptation, yield to sin. Most of us would like to believe that we would never be deceived or led astray, tempted to the point that we do something we know is wrong. And yet Paul said you need to consider yourself, because the same thing could happen to you. God's law to the erring in Acts 8:22 is, repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. And every brother who is surprised in a fault is precious, and we should make every effort to salvage them and restore them to the faith. Number five, the Bible teaches, as far as our interpersonal relationships are concerned, we should love our brother. 1 Peter 2:17, love the brotherhood. 1 Thessalonians 4:9, ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. 1 John 3:15, whosoever hates his brother is a murderer. 1 John 5:1, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him who begot also loves him who is begotten of him. What's John saying here? If we love Christ who begot us, then we love everybody else that Christ begets. That is, we love all of our brethren. Brotherly love is the love of Christians to Christians. It refers to that very special affection that believers have for each other, a virtue that was called with such perfection in the primitive church that it actually called forth the admiration of heathen adversaries. It is said that because of the closeness the early Christians had to each other and with each other, that the pagans marveled at that. And they were stricken by the fact that these people had extreme care for each other. Perhaps that's why Jesus made the statement, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you love one another. Now, why do we love each other? We love each other because we have the same Father. We love each other because we're brethren of the same Savior. We're members of the same family. We share the same grace, and we expect the same immortality. To all men, we are related by a common humanity, because we're all human beings. But to Christians, we are still more closely related by a common Christianity. We belong to each other because all of us belong to the Lord. And it will show in the acts of kindness done to believers in preferring their company to that of worldly men and conversing with them on the grand scheme of salvation. One more thought tonight before I close. The Bible teaches that we should pray for our brother. At the coronation of King Saul, Samuel made a speech to the people, and he closed that speech with the following words: moreover, as for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I will teach you the good and the right way. Far be it from me, Samuel said, that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. You know, tonight we have problems in the church, and we all have been affected by some of the recent departures from the faith that unfortunately some of our people have gotten into. And for a period of time, I was fairly active in trying to talk to people and try to get them to see where they were wrong, and I failed. And so I've reached the point in my life where I pray for these people all the time. I pray that somehow their heart will be touched with the truth, somehow their eyes will be opened, somehow they will realize the road they're traveling will take them farther and farther away from the Bible, the church, and Christ. I pray for them. That's all I know to do. When you talk to people and they refuse to listen to what you say, there's not much else you can do. But God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for them. You know, we often talk about each other, and sometimes we even criticize each other, and we even put each other down. But how often do we pray for each other? How often do we really just take the time to pray for somebody that we know is out of the way, or maybe has said something they shouldn't have said, or maybe done something they shouldn't have done, or may not be living as they should live? The truth is this, brethren. We can never make anybody do what's right. We can encourage it, we can hope for it, and we can pray for it. And that's what we all need to be doing. Many of us have members of our own family that are not living right. But you can't make people live right. But you can pray for them every day. Every day we can pray for them. And the Bible teaches, I believe, that we should. Samuel surely would have prayed for their strength, for their obedience, for their dedication, and for their faithfulness to God and His Word. And shouldn't we do the same? You know, our relationship to each other is a great relationship. And we need to cherish that relationship, and we need to behave toward one another as the children of God. Interpersonal relationships are extremely important in the church. And you know, really, as I survey the brotherhood and as I go from place to place, many instances, it's not that brethren are doing bad things. It's just that brethren don't seem to be able to get along with each other. There's always some little something that agitates, always something that people fall out over, always something that people get offended or get their feelings hurt about. And the truth of the matter is, we're just not very good sometimes at getting along with each other. We're not very good at recognizing our faults, our failures, our difficulties, and our need perhaps to be more expressive and more concerned. Instead of withdrawing and nursing our own hurt and our own feelings, if we could just bring ourselves to go to somebody and talk to them, we might be able to resolve the problem. And that's really what we need to do. We are our brother's keeper. I'm going to tell you, Abel had a horrible answer. His answer was horrible. I mean, Cain had a horrible answer when he was asked about his brother Abel. How do I know? Am I my brother's keeper? Yes, he was. But he didn't do a very good job being his brother's keeper. And we're not doing a very good job either sometimes. And so tonight, let's all of us take very close inspection of our actions, our reactions, our words, our prayers, our thoughts, and make sure that we really are our brother's keeper. Now, I want to say this to someone else, the other side, so to speak. When some brother comes to you and talks to you about your soul, don't get mad at him. Don't look at him and say, this is no business of yours, because it is his business. You're his brother. You're his sister. He's your keeper, just as you're his keeper. He has every right to be interested in you, every right to be concerned about you, every right to want to help you, every right to want to save you, every right to point out what you need to know about your salvation. And so don't mistake the fact that someone comes to you in an honest attempt to help you be a better person. Don't mistake the fact by accusing him of meddling in your business. He's merely taking care of business. And we all ought to be doing that. We all ought to be concerned enough about each other to go to each other and try to help that person get to heaven. Maybe you're here tonight and you're not a Christian. We don't want to close without giving you the opportunity to obey the gospel. Or if you've obeyed the Lord and you're not living as you should and you need to make some things right with God or the church, then I encourage you to come forward and confess those wrongs and we'll pray for you. Or if there's something here tonight that you need to straighten up with a brother, after we're dismissed, go to that brother. If he doesn't live here, call that brother. If you can't call him, write him a letter. I can't tell you how many times I've had people tell me after I preached this sermon or one similar to it that they went home that night and called somebody they hadn't spoken to in years and they worked out a difficulty. Difficulties can be worked out. Damage can be repaired. Churches can be salvaged and saved, and souls can be brought to the Lord if we only realize we're our brother's keeper. If you're here tonight and you're a subject of the gospel, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.